enter into his courts with praise and thanksgiving this morning as we begin to remember the birth of our Savior. So everyone together, let's sing from the rising of the sun.
Yes. From the rising of the sun to the ending of the day.
One name.
One name alone be praised, yes. Every nation, tribe, and tongue, all creation lifting up. Your name alone we raise.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless his name, only one name, now and always.
Yes, come on.
See the star on Christmas morn.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I am so glad that you've joined us today. My name is Heath Hatmaker, and I serve as the pastor of student ministry at Rolling Meadows. And I just love that we're all online together and watching the service. And it's crazy that I could be here and we could have people in Lithuania that are watching with us. If you're here again this week, welcome. But I want you to let us know where you're watching from. That would be so fun for us. And so let us know in the chat where you're watching from, and I want to make sure that you feel welcome to our services. And if you're new, or if you have been coming every single week and watching online, I want to invite you to check in. And that's a way that we are able to pray for you and able to get information from you in any way that we could be helpful. And so you can do that on this page through the link that just came through on your comments, or through the app, the Harvest Bible Chapel app. And so we just want to pray for you and care for you in the best way that we can. And so I would invite you now to check in. And I am excited for today's service. I'm so excited for Pastor Eddie Hoagland to be preaching today. We're actually concluding our series through the book of Romans. I have loved this series. It's called The Road to Reality. And I'm gonna encourage you right now to just grab your Bible and open up, maybe get a head start to Romans chapter 15. And that's where we're gonna be today as we finish up these series of messages. I am just so excited to finish it up. And if you've missed any of the messages, you want to watch them, trust me. All of them are online at harvestbiblechapel.org. And so go there this week and catch up so that you make sure you don't miss out on anything. I also am really excited. I love what God's been doing in our young adults ministry at our church here at Harvest. And if you're a young adult, single or married, and you're watching online right now and you're in the Chicagoland area, I wanna invite you to come on Thursday night, December 17th, to our Rolling Meadows campus at 6:30 p.m. I was able to actually preach at our last young adults night, and there was a ton of energy and excitement about what God is doing in this ministry. But vertical worship is gonna be there. There's gonna be food. There's gonna be teaching from God's word. We're gonna be wearing Christmas sweaters. So if you don't have one, I just picked one up from Woodfield Mall. They've got plenty left. You can go there. But we just hope to see you at the Young Adults Night. And all the information I just mentioned is at harvestnow.info. If you missed it, you can go grab it there. And it's almost Christmas, surprisingly. Like, I feel like this year has gone by quick and slow. I don't know for sure, but we want to make sure that you plan to spend Christmas with us at Harvest. And so the next two Sundays, our worship ministry has planned some incredibly special Christmas services. And so those will be online and in person on all of our campuses. And we don't want you to miss out for those next two weekends. And we have another Christmas experience I want to invite you to. Our Christmas Eve service is going to be available on demand, online, all day on Christmas Eve, Thursday the 24th. And you don't want to miss out on this service. It's going to be fun for the whole family. So invite your extended family over. If you guys are already doing something for Christmas, there's going to be Christmas music and a short message. And there's just going to be something for everybody. It's going to be engaging for the kids all the way to the grandparents. And so harvestnow.info is where you can get the details. We want to see you online for our Christmas Eve service. And we also want to see you in person this Friday and Saturday, December 18th and 19th, from 4:15, when it gets dark now, the winter, right? All the way to 9 p.m., we're doing Harvest's first ever outdoor Christmas event, and we're calling it Come and See, and that's a Christmas experience in lights. And it is going to be fantastic. I know our teams have been working for a long time to make this event incredible. It's gonna be a drive-through event at our Elgin campus, and you're gonna be able to hear the gospel, you and your family and friends, so invite others. You can tailgate, you can meet some of the church staff and friends. There's gonna be a Christmas market. The Kingdom Market's canceled, I'm so sad about, but we have a Christmas market. There's gonna be a live nativity, reindeer, a winter walk that you're able to go on. This is gonna be amazing. So like, I know what you're thinking, like what, $150 per car? Event is free. This is free for your family, but the space is limited. So we do need you to register, but I want you to invite your friends, your neighbors, your family, come with your small group. It is going to be an incredible, incredible couple of days. And all of those details and the link to register is at harvestnow.info. And so I want you to go there, and we will see you on those couple of days. And I wanted to share this announcement segment with a couple of my friends. Go ahead and watch this video now.
Well, hey Harvest, Pastor Tommy, and I'm with Tim Stoner. And Tim, you are on our elder board, and that's since right. May 2019, you've been the treasurer of our elder board.
That's
so
right, yes.
It's kind of fair to say that you're kind of the money guy in our church, right?
Well, I guess you could say that.
Yeah.
I would say I'm one of the money folks here at Harvest. Yeah. But my role as treasurer is to help lead our finance committee and to provide oversight for our church finance staff.
Now, that sounds like a pretty big job. And you do that all as a volunteer, right?
Yeah, I'm a volunteer, but there's an army of volunteers here at Harvest serving in many great ways.
Yeah.
And it really is an honor to serve the Lord in this way as an elder, and I get to work alongside some pretty amazing people.
Yeah, true. And, you know, 2020 has been kind of a crazy year in so many ways. And so can you share what that's meant for our church financially?
Sure, Pastor Tommy, thank you. Yeah. The Lord has been so faithful to us this year, as He has for many years in the past. And it has been a challenging year financially for many in our congregation, and we're aware of that. In fact, it has affected our giving. Our giving through November is $1.45 million behind our projected plan. However, our expenses are actually $2 million lower than we expected Wow. they would be through November. Wow. So what that means is that through November, we are actually ahead of our budget by $550,000.
Praise God.
Yeah. And you know, church leadership has really been encouraging us as we look ahead to 2021 to consider the book of Nehemiah, where the people of God saw God accomplish great things, impossible things, when they worked together toward a common goal, and when the Lord showed favor to them as well. And this year, He has shown us His favor, that we've been able to save $2 million in expenses when our giving has been a bit behind. We've done this because our staff has really worked hard to steward every dollar carefully, and we found some pretty creative ways to save that nearly $2 million.
Wow. That's awesome. And so what does all of that mean for us as we look at the year-end giving in December?
I'm glad you asked that question, Pastor Tommy. What that means is that our original giving projection for what we would need to end the year positive is actually $550,000 lower than we thought it would be. So our need for December 2020 is now $2.1 million.
Now, to me, that still sounds like a pretty large number.
It is a large number, yeah. But okay. Fortunately, it's consistent with our experience and what we've received from giving so far in 2020. In addition, December is usually a double give month, where we're used to receiving about twice as much as we receive in other months of the year.
So Tim, can you put that into perspective for us? How does that compare to last December?
Well, you may remember that in December 2019, we had quite a substantial financial need. In order to meet our expenses, we would have needed $4.5 million in December to finish in the positive. However, we ended up receiving just about $2.7 million, which required us to dip into our reserves last December. This year, our need is about 20% less than what we actually received in December 2019.
Wow. That's so helpful for me to hear and encouraging for me to hear, Tim. And so is there anything else that you'd like to add?
Yeah, just one last thing. I want to thank each person that has sacrificed this year and financially contributed to the ministries of Harvest Bible Chapel. I know that many of you have taken a great step of faith in a time of much uncertainty. But just as the Lord did in Nehemiah's day, God takes the gift of each one, and when He combines it with the gifts of the whole body working together, He accomplishes great things in and through us. And as we look to 2021, would you consider bringing your giving up to date or making a special year-end gift to help our church end the year in a financially healthy position? Thank you.
Well, thank you so much to Tim and to Pastor Tommy for that video. I hope that you're encouraged by that like I am. Matthew 6:21 says that for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And we just honestly want to see where God is at work in your life. And so we want to be a part of that. And as you consider your giving this month, I want to just remind you that there are four ways to give. I know that I've got them just memorized up here. Maybe you do as well at this point. You can give online, you can give through our app, you can give through a text, and you can mail your gifts into our Rolling Meadows campus. And we are just so thankful for what God is going to do with those gifts. And I just want to pray over those gifts and the rest of our service right now, if you would join me, okay? God, we are just so thankful. Man, that was a lot of things, a lot of incredible work that you are doing in this church. And that's what it is. It's your work, Lord. And we are excited to be a part of it. We're excited to witness it. And so, God, we ask that you would use these offerings, that you would use this service today and these people, your people, God, to do incredible things for your name's sake. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
All for you. I'll praise you for amazing grace. Amen. Up from the grave, up from the grave, into the dark, you called my name and brought
word Maranatha, and it literally meant come Lord Jesus. And that's a word that I think of when we get to this season, when we get to this Christmas season, because this season, this month, is a time where more than ever we're inviting Jesus to come. We talk about these scriptures that were prophecies of Jesus coming to the world. And we stand here as New Testament Christians living in a reality where Jesus has already come, but yet we're singing and we're saying, Lord, would you continue to come? Would you come? And what we're doing is we're asking, Lord Jesus, would you continue to permeate my life deeper and deeper, go further and further? Because there's definitely areas of my life that need more of the Lord, right? And so we're going to go through a few different prayers this morning. And we're going to say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. In the same way that we're echoing that from years and years ago in our faith, we're saying that for our lives right now, saying, Lord, would you come? Would you go deeper in my life? So as we worship the Lord today, let's invite him to come, just firstly in this room. Let's say it from our hearts, but say it out loud. Church, let's lift it up and say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Let's say that again. Just say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. And then turning our attention to our own hearts, that's when we become aware of our own sinfulness, how we've strayed far from the Lord. We remember our own thoughts, our own deeds, and we turn in repentance and we say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. And now let's turn our thoughts. Just take a second and think of someone in your life who doesn't know the Lord. Someone in your life who no doubt needs this prayer to be prayed over them, prayed into their lives. Now with that name in mind, with that person in mind, just say this as a prayer over them into their life and say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. And then we think about our own church family. For those of us gathered in this room, we know that so much of our church family is online as well, at home. And so saying it for this room, saying it for our church family, saying it for those who are watching online, saying it, speaking it into your own home, just go ahead and invite the Lord and say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. And finally, we think of our families, we think of our workplaces, we think of our cities, we think of our country, we think of all those who desperately need the Lord Jesus. And we pray this. We say, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Oh, Holy Spirit, Spirit, I pray. I know you're here, but just go deeper, Lord. Go deeper, Lord. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. Come on, you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the
touching every heart.
Let's sing our worship.
Just who is able to keep you from falling down, and to him who declares you wholly blameless in the sight of God. To you be the glory and all the honor. Now to him who is able to keep from falling down, and to him who declares you wholly blameless in the sight of God. You got it, church. Now to him, now to him who is able to keep you from
let it be so.
Jesus, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, would you be glorified? Would your name be lifted high above every other name? But not to us, but to your name be the glory, God. And in this place today, God, we just recognize who you are. We recognize the God that we are worshiping, the God that came from heaven to earth to save us, to rescue us, and give us new life again. We thank you for that, God. And thank you, Lord, that we can just rest. We can find our rest today, knowing that you are all powerful, that you are almighty, that you are ruling and reigning over every single thing, no matter big or small. We just recognize your presence in this place, at all of our campuses, Lord, all throughout Chicagoland today. Would you move in power? Would you speak again through your word, Lord? We are ready. We're ready. We want all of it, everything that you have for us, Lord. So our hearts are surrendered. Our hearts are inviting you in even deeper, even closer. We love you, Lord. We love you. We pray all these things in the most beautiful name there is, the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. It's so good to worship together, church. Yeah, we can do that. It feels like we haven't done that in a while. Why don't you take a seat? We're going to hear from God's word together today.
Good to see you. We are now welcoming all our campuses. We're welcoming Crystal Lake, Aurora, Rolling Meadows, the Cathedral Campus, and North Shore. And get this, for the first time since we've opened our campuses, we are now welcoming live the online campus. So let's welcome them who are joining us now. We're glad that you're here. Yeah, it's truly live right now. That's what I'm being told. So I am talking to all the campuses as well as all our online crew, and we are really thankful that we can be together in this way right now. And, you know, our teams have been working tirelessly to be able to do this. There was no handbook for 2020. We didn't know how to do what we've been doing, and the Lord has been so gracious to us. So I'm thankful for the teams that have put in countless hours in order to accomplish what we're doing right now, that we're all together, all campuses, as well as our online crew. Today, I want to talk about hope. I want to talk about hope because hope is one of those things that when, you know, when you're in conversation with someone, it's almost like there's this nonverbal communication of people kind of feeling like, I think they have hope, and they kind of get close, and they're kind of wondering, like, what do I need to do so that I can have what they have? And people clearly desire hope. I mean, we live in a hopeless world in so many ways, and that's why people desire hope. And so here's the definition we're going to use today as far as hope. Hope is the confident expectation that God will keep his promises. The confident expectation that God will keep his promises. See, it's not just something you have to think about. It's not just, I know he's going to keep his promises. No, it's a bit more than that. It affects your confidence. It affects our ability to say, yeah, I'm expecting that. I am so confident that God is going to keep his promises. So what I want to talk to you about today is walking confidently into tomorrow. How do we do that? How do we walk confidently into tomorrow? Because we have no idea what's coming tomorrow, right? If 2020's taught us anything, it's you don't know what's coming tomorrow. Your whole life could change in just an instant. And so we want to be able to head into whatever tomorrow is, but with confidence, with that hope that is available to us through Jesus Christ. Walking confidently into tomorrow. All right, let me pray as we get started. Father, I just I take a moment right here, and I just ask that you would use this for your glory, for all the things that we're going to see here in Romans chapter 15. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the way that it encourages us, the way that it pushes us where we need to be pushed, God. We're just so thankful for your word and ask that you would bless our time together here today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. All God's people said, amen. 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 All right, I'm going to be preaching from Romans chapter 15. I'm going to start in verse 4, and we're going to go through verse 13. Now, I have to explain just a little bit of the context of what's happening here with the Jews and the Gentiles. If you're not familiar with those terms, a Gentile is simply just someone who's not a Jew. So you have the Jews and the non-Jews. That's the Jews and the Gentiles. And we're going to address some of those things today because you remember back when the book started, Dr. Van Lanningham preached this verse, Romans 1:16, where it talks about the gospel being the power of God for anyone who believes. The gospel is the power of God for anyone. Someone say anyone. Anyone who believes. That's what the gospel is. But then it says this phrase. It says, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Which in the context of what Paul's talking about, he's saying also to the non-Jew, the Gentile. Why the Jew first? What is he talking about? Well, let me just give you just a super high-level view of what we're talking about here with the Jews and the Gentiles. Going back to the Old Testament, it starts with God making a covenant with Abraham, that he would make a nation out of Abraham from his lineage, and that this nation would be blessed. That's the nation of Israel. Then God makes a promise to King David that from David's lineage would come the Messiah, would come the anointed one to save his people. And they thought he was going to save them from the Roman oppression, but he came to save them from their sins. So Jesus comes and he dies on the cross and he makes a covenant with his body and his blood to offer salvation from sin to those who believe, to those who believe. But see, many of the Jewish people, they rejected Jesus as the Messiah. They did not receive him for who he was. But God saved those who believed that Jesus was, in fact, who he said he was. And the gospel is available to the Gentiles as well now, because the picture uses that there's an olive branch, and the Gentiles are grafted into that covenant through Jesus Christ. Hey, that's really good news, and it's also really good news because it was prophesied all along, okay? So you have to remember, the Gentiles being added to, as the people of God, was not like plan B for God. This was prophesied in the Old Testament. It was his plan all along. And what's coming in the future, in the end times, is that God's going to fully restore Israel. And both Jews and Gentiles will form part of God's fully formed kingdom as we walk into eternity. That is what's to come. So here in Rome, what's happening is you have Jewish believers and you have Gentile believers, but now they're in the same church. Okay, so there is a merging of cultures happening. And I grew up in a bicultural family, and so I'm very familiar with what it is to merge cultures. And what that means, there's a little bit of tension sometimes, a little bit of a learning curve. And I mean, every family that, when someone gets married, that's a merging of cultures no matter what. But we had the merging of the American culture and the Mexican culture in our household. And that's what's happening here in this church in Rome. There's a merging of cultures between the Jewish believers and the Gentiles. And here the big issue was that the Gentiles had no issue eating meat that was offered to idols because they had grown up eating that meat. That wasn't a big deal for them. Whereas for the Jewish believers, that was a big deal because they had a tradition not to touch that meat, and because it was so close to idolatry that they had a tradition that said, just don't mess with it, don't touch it at all. Now, what's interesting is that was it wasn't a biblical law. They wouldn't be breaking the law if they would have eaten that. It was actually a tradition, which I found out this week. I thought for sure it was a rule that used to be, and now it's not. No, it was just a tradition that they were enforcing, and then they were doing what all of us do so well. They were judging each other, okay? So the Jews were looking at the Gentiles, judging them, thinking less of them because of them eating the meat. And then the flip side, I'm sure it was true, where the Gentiles are like, what's wrong with these guys? Like there was judging happening. And this happens all the time in church world. Let me just give you one easy example, dressing up on Sundays, right? So if you come from a tradition that you kind of got a little bit you know, dressed a little fancier. Maybe you're like this guy. We got suit guy on one side, and he, you know, he wore a suit every Sunday, and that's his tradition. And look, there's nothing wrong with that. Obviously, there's nothing wrong with that. But then on the other side, you got casual guy, and he just dresses kind of like what he looks like normally during the week, and that's how he comes to church, and there's nothing wrong with that either. The problem comes when they start judging each other. When suit guy over here looks at casual guy, and he's like, look at that guy. He doesn't even take the Lord seriously. Obviously, look at him. He's coming to church in jeans, you know? And then casual guy's over here, and he could do the exact same thing. He could look over at suit guy and be like, oh, that guy thinks he's so holy. He thinks he's got the Bible memorized. He's in a suit. Like, who's he think he is, right? The judging is the problem. And what I'm saying is, honestly, you can come to church as suit guy, as casual guy. I don't care. But we should not be judging one another based off the choice we make. Okay? Harvest Bible Chapel is a place where you can come dressed just as you are, or a little bit fancy if you like, or I guess I'm kind of somewhere in between those guys, I would guess. But whatever you want to, however you would like to come, here's the important thing. God sees your heart. Okay, so we're going to be about the heart in this place, and we're not going to judge one another just like these Jews and Gentiles were judging one another. So that's the backdrop here in Romans chapter 15, where Paul is teaching us about the unity in the church, and we're going to learn from him the principles. The principles are right here that will let us walk confidently into tomorrow. We're going to be able to do that by the end of the sermon. We're going to be able to walk confidently into tomorrow if we do these things. Okay, so the first thing, how are we going to walk confidently into tomorrow? Point one, side by side in unity. Side by side in unity. Let's read Romans chapter 15, starting in verse 4. For whatever was written in the former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus. See, so what verse 4 is teaching us, that what happened in the past, so here he's talking about the Old Testament, what happened in the scriptures in the past is there to inform your present. And if you apply it in the present, it will then give you hope as you look towards the future. So when it talks about endurance, we're talking about the capacity to stand firm in the face of difficulty. That's what endurance is. It's that you have the strength to continue. You have the ability to bear up during difficult times. That's what endurance is. And then when he talks about encouragement from the scriptures, you know, when you encourage someone, you're giving them courage. You're giving them the ability to say, like, yes, I can do this. But specifically in this passage here, it's also closely related to comfort, because in the scripture you're going to find encouragement. It's going to comfort your soul. The Word of God is both these things. The Word of God is both the means for you to endure, and it's the comfort you need to find hope. It's both those things. It's the means for you to endure and the comfort you need to find hope. See, the Bible is a place where we go to get comfort, right? We can all relate to that. But this verse is teaching us that it's also our way to endure hardship. Because maybe you're like me, and when it's time to endure, I don't always run to God's word right away. I'm just being honest. My personality is a bit different. I'm more like, just suck it up, like just press in, like just do more, get through it. And then once I feel like I'm kind of getting through it, then I start going to the scriptures to find my comfort for my soul. But God has a better way. He has a better way for you, and he has a better way for me. And that is that being in the Word of God is also our means to endure. Notice what he said in verse 5. Let's read that verse again. It says, verse 5, may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus. So I love how Paul shows us that we find in the Word of God, obviously, what comes from who? From God himself. He's the God of endurance. He's the God of encouragement, because he's the God who is the source of our ability to endure, and he's also the one who lets us receive encouragement. So when you're reading your Bible and you find strength to endure, just remember that that came from the God of endurance. That came from God himself, that strength. And when you find comfort in God's word, Maybe just say a prayer right then and say, God, thank you. Thank you for encouraging me. I receive that as from you. So always remember, this book isn't God himself, but it's God's word. And he is the God of endurance. He is the God of encouragement. And our God wants us to live in harmony with one another. We talked about this last week, actually. That phrase means to have a common mind, that we would have so much agreement between us, walking side by side in unity. I picked that phrase because I had in mind like some sort of like medieval army, you know, and they're all standing together, and you see thousands of soldiers with swords or maybe on horseback, and I think of how they're standing side by side physically, but that represents the fact that they're standing side by side in purpose. They're all there for the same reason. They've been recruited to a mission, and that's why they're there as soldiers. And it makes me think of, you know, sometimes I do this. I kind of like try to put myself in Satan's shoes and look at the army of God and say, what would he be thinking, right? If he saw the church standing side by side as an army, would he look at the church and say, you know, okay, so here are my options as Satan. I can attack them, or another option is I could just find a way for them to just attack each other. Because if they're attacking each other, I don't really have to do anything. And sometimes we're so focused on the attack of Satan. You know what I'm afraid of? I'm afraid of the indifference of Satan. That Satan would look at the church and say, yeah, I'm good. I don't have to do much there. Because they're just eating each other up. They're spending all their time fighting with each other instead of fighting for the mission that Jesus Christ had given them as the head of the church. I fear the indifference of Satan. I never want it to be that Satan would look at our church and be like, yeah, I don't really have to do anything there. It's just kind of happening. No, we should be standing side by side in unity and be a threat to him, be a threat to his causes. And like I said, standing side by side in purpose. That's how the church should walk into tomorrow. Whatever battle is ahead of us, we're going to stand next to each other, okay? And we are together in purpose. What's our purpose? It's the same mission we've had all along. We are here to glorify God through the fulfillment of the Great Commission. That's what I'm here to do, and I hope that's what you're here to do. That's why we can stand by side in unity, because we're giving ourselves to that mission that we would glorify God through the fulfillment of the Great Commission. We stand side by side together in unity. Then this, verse 6, we're going to see that we are to walk confidently into tomorrow, glorifying God together. That's point two, glorifying God together. Let's read verse 6. It says, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so to glorify, that word means to influence others, to influence other people, to see God as great. So whatever you're doing in action, in word, that is influencing other people to see God as awesome. They're like, God must be awesome, because if not, this person wouldn't be doing these things. That's what it means to glorify God. So yes, of course that means what we just did in our worship service. That glorifies God, because we're showing him to be great. We're giving him all the praise. But it's not just in worship, it's also in outreach. We're glorifying God every time we leave this building and we go out into the community and we share the love of Jesus Christ with them, and they look at us and they're like, why would people do the things that they're doing? You know why? It's because we have a God who loves you, and that's what we're trying to tell you. And when we're on mission together and when we spend our time in unity side by side, what that does is it glorifies God with one voice. I love that phrase Paul uses. He says, together with one voice. And that refers to the fact that with one voice, that we have that unity inside, but it not only stays inside, it's expressed together. So so let me illustrate it this way. All right, Dallas, you're going to be a part of this illustration. So go ahead and stand up. He's very happy to participate, I'm sure. okay, Dallas, I'm going to ask you to just say four words. And you are one voice, so you're going to declare this with your one voice. And here's a phrase I picked. It's an important phrase for us. It's one of the things that unites us. I'm going to ask you to say, here in a second, you're going to say, Jesus Christ is Lord. OK, Okay, so when we say Jesus Christ is Lord, we're saying he's the guy in charge here, okay? He's the boss. Yeah, whatever he says, we want to obey. Whatever he decrees, we want to fulfill. He is King Jesus. He is Lord. And so, so Dallas, after the count of three, you're just going to say that phrase, Jesus Christ is Lord. All right, here we go. 1, 2, 3. Amen. Do you believe that?
I do.
That's awesome. Jesus Christ is Lord, and that's what Dallas is declaring. All right. Now, every single person in this section, you guys now stand up. All right? And everybody else, you just get ready. It's coming to you. So whatever you need to put down, all the other campuses, go ahead and put down whatever you need to put down. We're all going to end up standing up by the end of this illustration, so just get ready for that. All right. Now, every single person who is in this section, now we're going to unite your voices with what Dallas said, that Jesus Christ is Lord. All right? Let me hear you. 1, 2, 3.
Jesus Christ,
amen. Now we're starting to unite our voices, starting to grow in volume. You start to sense, how could it be that so many people could believe the same thing? Well, that's because it's a really important thing. All right, the rest of Elgin, go ahead and stand up. Campuses, we're coming to you. Just hold on. Don't get ahead of me. All right, it's going to start here. To Elgin first, and then to the Gentile. No, I'm just kidding. So we're going to start here with Elgin. All right, every single person in this room, lift up your voice. Here we go. 1, 2, 3.
Jesus Christ.
All right, we just went from one voice to, I don't know, somewhere like 50 voices, and now we're in the hundreds. All right, every other campus, no matter where you are, you better get up right now, okay? I know I can't see you, but God sees you. So go ahead and stand up. Crystal Lake, Aurora, Rolling Meadows, North Shore, Cathedral, every single person in the room standing up. Now you're going to join your voice with our voice as we say this together. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. See, now we're in the thousands of people. Thousands of people are declaring that Jesus Christ is Lord. And hold on, I'm not done. Hold on. Don't forget who we're missing. We're missing our online crew. All right, if you're watching this online, I don't know where you are, but you better stand up, okay? It takes a little bit longer for them because they're like deep in the recliner with their pajamas. So we're going to give you just a few extra seconds. All right, every single person, you are the online crew. Now you're joining us. And get this. This is what's so crazy. With adding the online crew, we have people not just in Chicagoland, we have people all around the country joining us right now. We have people, this blows my mind, all around the world. So there's people somewhere in other continents that are waking up at awful hours to join us. So every single person who can hear the sound of my voice, here we go, together, we say 1, 2, 3.
Jesus Christ is Lord.
Come on, say it one more time. 1, 2, 3. All right, someone better give praise to the Lord right now in this place. Lift up your voice. He's worthy of that. Yes, Lord. He is Lord. He's in charge here. He's the one that we worship. All right, you can sit down. Everybody sit down. See, now that gives me hope. That gives me confidence to walk into tomorrow. That there are thousands of us who believe that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that he is the name above every single name, and he's the one that we worship in this place. We stand side by side in unity. We're glorifying God together. Then this, we're welcoming all people. We're welcoming all people. Verse 7 says this, therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. Specifically, here we're talking about welcoming other Christians warmly who are different than us. See, Paul is about to support this principle he's teaching, and he's going to address the divide that existed between the Jews and the Gentiles. And the way he's going to do that, he's going to actually quote the three big heroes from the Old Testament. He's going to quote David, he's going to quote Moses, and Isaiah. So if you were a Jewish listener right now, you'd be like, that's a pretty good lineup you got there, Paul. These are some big names in the Old Testament, and he is going to speak about these Old Testament passages that are talking to the Jews about the inclusion of the Gentiles to be the people of God. That's what he says here now in verse 8. For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised, that's the Jewish nation, to show God's truthfulness, God's faithfulness, what? In order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. Why are the Gentiles glorifying God for his mercy? Because they've been grafted in to the people of God. They now get to participate in this covenant as it is written. So this is Psalm 18:49. He says, "Therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles and sing to your name." And again it is said, now Deuteronomy 32:43, he quotes, "Rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people." And again, now Psalm 117:1, "Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples extol him." And Isaiah closes with Isaiah 11:10, where he says, "The root of Jesse will come." The root of Jesse will come. The Messiah, the lineage of David, he will come. Merry Christmas. That's what Christmas is about right there. The root of Jesse will come, and then it says, "Even he who arises to rule the Gentiles, in him will the Gentiles hope." In Jesus will the Gentiles hope. He's saying to the Jewish believers, the Gentiles are your brothers and sisters in Christ. Even if they're different than you, they're still your brothers and sisters. Now, check this. This book was written to believers over 1,000 years ago. And you would have thought that we would have learned our lesson by now, that we're supposed to truly welcome one another. And that means that you are to be in fellowship with, to be in a relationship with those who are different than you. Harvest Bible Chapel should be a place where anyone can walk in and they could know that they can belong here. It's a place where they can be in fellowship. It's a place where they can build relationships in Christian community, even if they're different. Because here's the thing, there's all different kinds of people in the family of God. So I'm going to apply this now to us here with some contemporary examples. And yes, I'm going to go there. So you just need to pray for me a little bit right now. And please just give me the graciousness as I share my heart on how I think there might be some areas we could grow in welcoming all people, welcoming one another into our Christian community here. All right, first, I'm going to talk about ethnic culture. So I use the term ethnic culture rather than race. To me, I'd rather not use the word race just because specifically for me, race always feels like I'm making the gap between me and someone else even larger. The term race almost sounds like you're a different race. Like to me, I hear you're almost like a different thing than what I am. Like you're not a human. And so I'd rather use the term ethnic culture because there are differences, but guess what? They're cultural and they're visual, but they all come from an ethnicity, a cultural difference. And there are many, many subsets, and I can't even go into all of it, but here's what I want to talk about. I feel like people are kind of giving themselves a pass in regards to welcoming people from other ethnic cultures than your own. I feel that way because I think a lot of people think, well, everyone's allowed to come to our church, right? Like, we would never say, you're not allowed in here because you're from a different ethnic culture. We would never do that. Yeah, I understand that. Praise God that we're not doing that. But maybe we don't discriminate with our permission to attend anymore, but do we discriminate with our willingness to proactively pursue a relationship with someone? To reach out to them rather than to wait until someone comes to meet us? A few months ago, I called one of my dear brothers who comes to Harvest, and he's African-American, and I just asked him like a very simple question. I was like, can you just tell me what it was like the first time you came to Harvest? I just want to know. Like, no, you can say anything you want. Just tell me honestly, what was it like? And he told me, he was like, yeah, well, I walked in, and the first thing I noticed was that me and my wife were the only people who looked different. and then he said that he described his lobby experience as really cold for him. And I said, okay, what does that mean? Describe what cold meant. And he said, well, it just felt like non-verbally, like no one really wanted to talk to me personally. And now here's the thing, after a while, he actually, he's an extrovert, so it's just like in his nature, he started reaching out and started building relationships and building those conversations. So he broke that first wall that was in the way. And guess what he found? He found out that we do have some of the most warm and loving people you can find anywhere. And so I'm like, well, if that's true, then why was it that when you walked in, you didn't feel that? And it's because of the first wall that was between him. And that's really what this addresses, that we would welcome one another. I just think, you know, if we could just get to the place where it doesn't require the person who's new or who looks different or who feels different because they're from a different ethnic culture, for them to reach out to us, what if we just reached out to them? What would start changing? How much more welcome would people from every ethnic culture, I'm not just talking about African Americans, every single different subset of an ethnic culture, what would happen? Because the bigger the gap between a person's ethnic culture and yours, I think all the more reasons you should just reach out. Break that first wall. What could happen if we're all committed to that, to breaking that first wall, and then just start building a relationship like we all know how to do? You walk up and you say, hey, my name's Eddie. What's your name? I'm not talking about some big, deep thing. I'm just talking about building relationships and letting us break that first wall. And I know I'm also just talking about the lobby experience with my example, but can I just say, if it's not happening there, why would we be confident it's happening other places? I'm just trying to bring up the point, like, let's start there, and let's let that inform the rest of our culture at the church to make sure it's not just saying, oh, well, I'm not rejecting anyone. No. Like I talked about last week, it's not just about not doing the wrong thing. It's about doing the right thing, okay? And we are to welcome one another, that you would reach out and welcome someone. So ethnic culture, another point I thought of was nationality, because it's a little different, obviously a different culture, but there are people who come to our church who aren't American citizens, and when they step in, it's different. And I have a little bit of experience, because now I'm both American and I'm Mexican, so it's not quite, I don't consider myself like a true foreigner in the sense that I had a lot from my dad. He taught me a lot about the American culture before I even moved here. But there are people who don't have that at all. And there might even be a language barrier or some more obvious visual differences because they come from a different nation. Well, this is just me sharing my heart. Here's a little tip, because when I came to the United States and people found out that I was from Mexico, it tended to happen like a similar way. First, I tell them, yeah, I'm from Mexico, and then someone would say, oh, New Mexico? And then I'm like, no, that's your country still. I'm from a different country. It's called Mexico. And then they're like, oh, Mexico. They're like, yeah, oh, I went on vacation in Mexico. I love Mexico, you know? Cancun, that's a great place, you know? And you know, while I was there, I had this waiter. His name was Jose. He was the sweetest guy. Do you know him? Yes, 120 million people, and that's the Jose I know. You found him, you know? We go way back. Me and Jose, we go way back. No, of course not. And so here's the point. Obviously, the heart in that was right. The heart in that conversation was to connect. I'm just trying to share a little tip that I would say maybe putting the spotlight on the differences of their nationality right away is not the best play. Because you're kind of forcing them to be like, I don't know how I feel about this. You're basically, I'm walking into the room, I feel a little uncomfortable, and you're bringing up all the things of why I feel uncomfortable, because I'm different. So maybe the best way to go would be just say, hey, my name's Eddie, what's your name? And then just let that nationality topic come up a little bit later. And the reason I'm bringing it up is because I believe that will help break that first wall better and help them feel welcome, because people from any nation, tribe or tongue, anyone, you are welcome here at this church. And if that speaks to you, if you're one of those people who you're not a citizen of the country, can you just hear this from us? You're welcome here. We're glad that you're here. And we want to make sure that you know that you are welcome here. Y si tal vez tú vienes de un país latinoamericano, queremos que sepas que aquí tú puedes encontrar familia. And if I spoke another language, I'd say it in that language too. But that's all I got. All I got is Spanish. But we want you to know, I'm just making the point that no matter where you're from, you can belong here. All right, so we have ethnic culture divides, maybe nationality differences. Then I'll just share, hopefully quickly, we have political differences. Okay, let me just say this. Lord knows I did not want to talk about this at this time of year, at this point in history. But I feel like I need to be faithful here to Romans chapter 15, because this is definitely one of the divides we have. And look, every Christian has to wrestle down how to vote their values, how their values are represented on any election. And until the day Jesus runs for president, guess what? There's going to be some differences on how Christians make those decisions. That's just the way it's going to play out. But the important thing is that there's no political party affiliation that's required for you to belong here. You do not have to have that. We don't even have to talk about that for you to belong here. Harvest isn't Democrat. Harvest isn't Republican. What we do here is we teach people what it means to follow Jesus. And so we don't represent a political party, and you don't have to either. We represent the kingdom of God to the world. That's what we're doing. Amen. So the point is this. I don't need to know who you voted for you to belong here. We don't even have to talk about that. You can belong here, and I don't need to know that. The last category I'll talk about is just the socioeconomic differences that we have. It's just a reality that there are vast differences between, you know, some people make more, some people make less. But here's the thing. I just want to bring up the fact that statistically what happens, and yes, inside of churches, is that families tend to befriend and become close friends with other families who have a house that's basically the same size as theirs. It just tends to happen because they have more in common. And again, I'm not trying to tell you to get rid of some of your friends. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, could you just maybe reach out to someone who might be a little different than you? Because here's the thing we have in common. We're all stewards of whatever God's entrusted to us. So if God entrusted you with a lot, you have to be a good steward of that. And if God trusted you even with what you would consider a little, you still have to be a biblical steward of that. And the scriptures actually speak specifically of making sure we're not giving special favor to those who have more wealth. And so that's why I just want to make sure that as a church, that's not a big deal here, that people can have more and it's not weird. People can have less and it's not weird. We're not trying to put that wall up between us. We're willing to reach past that first wall and break it down because we are the church. And so I can kind of feel some of you, like, you're struggling. You feel like, well, I'm not doing anything wrong, Eddie. Like, I'm not doing anything to stop those friendships. And I'm trying to tell you, I understand that. I'm not trying to scold you. Listen, I understand that you're not doing anything to stop it. I'm asking you, are you doing anything to proactively seek it? That's the point I'm trying to bring up to you. So as I look through those list of things, I'm like, my response is, how in the world are we going to do that? Like, how in the world are we going to break down all those walls? Well, the answer to that question, the answer to how in the world are we going to do that, is the last point of this message. Hear me. By the power of the Holy Spirit. By the power of the Holy Spirit is the answer to that question. Verse 13 finishes, and I close with this. It says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. How are we going to walk confidently into tomorrow? By the power of the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit is the one who enables you to do these things. But you have to yield to Him. You have to submit to Him. And look, I can't explain to you perfectly. How is it that the Holy Spirit leads my life, my Christian walk, and how is it that I, you know, what's my part, what's His part? I can't explain that to you. All I can tell you is, by experience, I know He's involved and I know I'm involved. And what my involvement is just listening and saying, yes, Lord, whatever it is that I think He's prompting me, I want to submit, I want to yield. And if you do that, you will start seeing the difference. You will start seeing the power of the Holy Spirit. It's by the power of the Holy Spirit you're going to be able to endure that hardship. When you say, I just don't have it, I can't keep going, and then you say, Lord, would you just give me the strength to stand? Just give me the strength to keep facing this adversity. You know how you're going to receive it? It's going to be through the power of the Holy Spirit Himself. And then when you say, I need that encouragement, I need that comfort from Scripture, I need to find it in the pages that are before me. The Holy Spirit already inspired this book, but you know what else He does? He'll make things start standing out to you. You know how you're seeing, you're like, oh, I feel like that's God saying that to me right now in this moment. The way that's happening is by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then you look around and you say, how are we supposed to live in harmony? Look at all the differences. We're such different people. We have so many different opinions. How are we going to do it? By the power of the Holy Spirit. You submit to the Holy Spirit. You submit to His word and listen to Him. And here's what's going to happen. He's going to grow you. He's going to grow me. And then we're going to grow together. That's how it's going to happen. By the power of the Holy Spirit. And then how in the world could we welcome one another? How could we do something better that is a disaster out in the world? And we look outside the doors of the church and we see chaos. We see tension. we see fighting, and we want to do something different here. How are we going to do that? We're not going to do it. You know how we're going to do it? It's through the power of the Holy Spirit himself. God is going to do it through you. God is going to do it through me. And we're going to be filled with joy. We're going to be filled with peace by the power of the Holy Spirit. We're going to be walking confidently into tomorrow, side by side, in unity, glorifying God together, welcoming one another, welcoming all people by the power of the Holy Spirit. So to close out, I just want to pray what Paul prayed to the church in Rome. I just want to pray that verse, verse 13, over you, over our church, over anyone who's listening. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Father, thank you for meeting us here. You are the source of our hope. You are the source of our ability to endure, and you are the source of our encouragement. Thank you for the work you've done here. Help us to apply your word and to be doers of it. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Man, what a fantastic service. I'm so grateful for the hope that we have in Jesus Christ, and thankful for Pastor Eddie's message and the fact that he reminded us of that today. And before you close out the service, can I just tell you that we would love to pray for you. There are staff that are online still, even though the service is over technically, and they would love to just pray for you. And so you can reach out through the live prayer button or just through the link in the comments, and we just want to care for you. We want to be here for you. We are in different places, different states, maybe countries, but we are together, and we're gathered together, and so we would love as a staff just to pray for you this week. And as you go, I want you to know that you are loved.